The critical angle is the smallest incident angle for which it occurs. Any angle bigger than that will also cause it. Does that make sense to you? At critical angle, I get total and real reflection. Any angle bigger than that is going to refract even more than 90 degrees, so it's clearly never going to refract. It just totally reflects, which is why we call total internal reflection, because there's always some reflection. But when all of it is reflected, then that's where critical angle comes in. Yeah. Oh, yeah, I just thought it was just, was not saying anything new or anything, by the way. Basically just saying, as I go, I make this angle bigger and bigger, there's going to be a critical angle where it would totally internally reflect. Any angle bigger than that will still totally internally reflect. All right? So once we find that place, it's the smallest angle for which it happens, but any angle bigger than that will also cause it. So we call that theta crit. Your author sometimes calls it theta C. I don't like that because when we have problems with more than one angle, we often have theta A, theta B, B, theta C, and theta C. So in fact, one of the problems you have, you've got a theta C, but it isn't theta crit. And so just be alert to that, because one problem we have theta C with the critical angle, and then the diamond one, theta crit and theta C are different. Whatever. All right, so how do I solve for this? It turns out it's really, really easy. All right, because when we go to Snell's law, we have n1 sine theta 1 is equal to n2, and I stop. I don't write sine theta 2. Why? Because that it happens at 90, and sine of 90 is 1. So we don't even bother to write it. So n1 sine theta 1 equals n2. This defines the critical angle. It can only happen going from high index to low index. It can never happen the other way. So you have to go from something with a high index of refraction to something with a lower index of refraction, but not necessarily air, just anything that's lower. Okay? If I were to get a jewel that had been designed to have a certain critical angle in the air, if I now held it underwater, would it still have the same critical angle? No. It would, because we can no longer assume that, I mean, if this is air, I put n1 as 1. If it's water, I have to put 1.33, and that's clearly going to change the angle. Right.
So it doesn't matter what you're going from. Say you're going from water to the 1.5, then it would be n1 would be n1.
I can't go from water to 1.5, because I have to go to something that's less. And water's so I can go from glass to water, and I'd have critical. I can go from glass to air, critical, water to air, critical. But if I go from air to any of those things, I can never get critical. You have to go from a high index to a lower. It doesn't matter by how much, but it has to be lower.
So when you talk about diamonds, does each facet have a critical angle?
No. So a critical angle is based on what the material is. So basically, the idea of a diamond, and I'm not going to get too much into this just right now, but the basic idea is this. If you design a diamond, this is a typical diamond cut. All right, and what typically is happening is if I have light come in at some angle, it's going to get refracted. It's going to hit here, and it turns out that if you follow this all the way through, that once it reflects, it when it hits the surface, it can't get out. It's totally internally reflected here. It's totally internally reflected here. And so any light that goes in comes right back out the front of the diamond. Why would this be a good thing?
Gives it that fire.
It makes them sparkle.
Yeah.
And that's what they're famous for. And it's for real. Diamonds sparkle more. I mean, a good eye can immediately tell whether something's cut zirconium instead of diamond because of the sparkle. So a trained eye knows what to look for. And diamonds do look different. It's just a fact. They look different. They have the highest index of refraction than anything else.
I might have missed it earlier, but you said that you can't have a total internal reflection going from a lower density to a higher.
A lower index of refraction to higher. But diamonds have really high. So when I come in here, if it's air on the other side of this, they would. Then they can have total internal reflection at this interface because they stay in the diamond, and that forces them to come out back into the air on the other side.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
All right. So, and I'll get more to that. So, now, any problem that involves total internal reflection or critical angle, this is where you're going to go. All right. So, this is where you're going to go. And this solves a minimum. Anything bigger than that is also going to be critical. So let's take a look. So they tell me I've got some substance and it has, so we're going back, say, I've got stuff, the critical angle is 42.5 in air. They have to specify that because for water it'd probably be different. But in air, as I go from this substance to air, I have 42.5 as my critical. What is the index of refraction of this substance? How do I start? Well, I come here. So what did the in air tell me? N2. I'm going to make my N2 1. Everybody get that? So I make this 1. And they said sine of 42.5. That's a given. And what is N1? Well, duh, we're there, right? So how do I solve? In this case, I just divide this to this side and I get my N1. But if it were something else, if it's 1.33 sine theta crit going to air, how do I find the critical angle going to air if I know the index of diffraction? So I just say theta crit equals the arc sine of 1 divided by 1.33. In fact, this is a general thing. The critical angle is the arc sine of the ratio of the indices. There, or the lower one always on the top. How do I know the lower one has to be on the top? It's a math reason.
Sine has to be less.
You cannot take the arc sine of anything bigger than 1. Right? It's not defined. So you know the bigger one has to be on the bottom to make the math work. Is everybody good with that? Alright. So the other thing, this is minor, but as I was doing the homework, because of the way the author pulls the homework problems in, you'll see two different phrases, and I know when you're first learning things, this can be confusing. Index of refraction and refractive index are exactly the same thing. Alright, so refractive index or index of refraction, just two ways of saying the same thing. So if you got your calculators out, I've got a substance with an index of refraction of 1.57. I'm going to place it in air. What is the critical angle? So it's got 1.57 index of refraction. I'm putting it in air. What is the critical angle?
39.6.
What is that?
Same answer?
Okay, yeah. I have 1.57 and air. Everybody get that? 39.6? I have 39.56?
Yeah.
All right. All right, so do it for water. Find the critical angle for water. Okay. So, are y'all comfortable with that? Everybody's good? All right. So,
what did you get?
I didn't punch it.
What's the?
I got 57.9.
You got what?
57.9.
For water?
Something.
No. That's too big. So how did you do it? Did you use 1.33?
Yeah. Divided by.
You 1 divided by 1.33 and take the arc sine.
I didn't do that.
What did we do?
It's around 48. Yeah. All right, so here's the other thing then. If I have that problem we did last time in class with a block of glass in the water, so the setup that we have a block of glass, somehow they're suspended in water, and we have light coming from the water in to the block of glass, and again, that makes it look like that. So at this point, I'm totally in the glass, and then I come out at some new angle. All right, so the question was, given theta 1, find theta 2. If glass has an index of refraction of 1.5, water has 1.33, and air has 1. So given that this is, let's say this is 30 degrees. All right. So first off, going from water to glass, is there any chance that I would get total internal reflection of the water and it wouldn't keep going. I'm going from the water, this piece of glass, I want to know, can I get total internal reflection as this beam hits that interface? Is there any chance it would simply reflect down instead of going on through the glass?
No.
Why?
Sine inverse.
Because this is a bigger index of refraction. The only way you get total internal reflection is to be bigger than where you start. I mean, smaller than where you start. So when it's bigger, it'll never, ever happen because this angle will always be smaller than this angle. All right? So what's there? We call this theta 2. I'll call this theta 3. And do you all understand that if this is theta 2, this is also theta 2? All right. So we did this last time, and maybe you remembered, and maybe you didn't. So the question that I have for you is, does the glass change anything?
No.
It's basically removal from the system because the theta 3 is going to be what it is, no matter how thick, no matter how, what, it doesn't matter what that block is made out of, as long as it's bigger, has a bigger index of refraction than water.
Yes.
Okay? So that's an important part of that problem. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to work through this next one, and if you see me hesitating and pausing and scratching my head a little bit, I worry that I will lose you. So try to save it. Okay? It's not difficult, it really isn't, but it's a little bit challenging to maybe particularly think of. So I'm coming to the glass, and what we typically do on this is they bevel this, there's no reason for that, but it's, some of that's for beauty. Alright, and so basically, here's what we've got going. I've got light coming in at some angle, and it refracts some position down here. And what I want to know is, what angle does this need to be to make sure I get total internal reflection on this interface? Yeah?
What do you mean total internal reflection? What?
Critical angle. Total internal reflection means nothing gets transmitted. It all stays inside.
Okay.
Right? So what we're going to do is we're going to call this theta A. All right? And I'm going to call this theta C. And I'm going to call this theta B. I'll explain my reasoning for this in just a moment. First off, theta A is what's coming in. We're good with that, right? Is going to refract as it enters the diamond. I'm calling that theta B. Everybody understand? Cool with that? Whatever that is, whatever's going on there, when it comes down and hits at this point, the angle with which it hits is theta C. Right? Because that's with respect to the normal. And my question is theta C the critical angle? All right? Or what value of theta C, I mean, if I have the critical angle, what value of alpha basically gets me where I want to go, blah, 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 blah. All right. So, how do we work our way through this? The first thing all we're really trying to do is find out what's the critical angle for diamond. And it turns out, I think I wrote that down somewhere. All right, so they're doing it for blue light. And I'll have to explain this. The index of refraction for blue light and diamond is 2.450. Four significant digits. And to do this problem, we're going to keep all four. It turns out that one of the things we haven't really done yet is every color has a slightly different index of refraction. What proof do we have of this?
Rainbows.
Right? Rainbows are because not every color actually has exactly the same index of refraction. So they had to specify blue because at the precision we're doing, we have to say which one we're doing because the four significant digits, they look different. So I'm saying, okay, yeah, I have an index of refraction of 2.450. Can I figure out what my critical angle would be using that, going from diamond to air? Do everybody understand that I can do that? Yes, Andrew.
So if different materials change the speed of light within that material, right? the velocity of light, sorry?
Different colors have, they bend different
right.
amounts within the same material, yes.
Is that because the frequency or the wavelength is changing in that material?
This is a very deep question, by the way. Typically, but nowadays we have ways to do it, but typically frequency can't change, wavelength does change.
Yeah.
Right?
Okay.
And the reason for that is as follows. Is that frequency is how often something happens. So if I tap the wood 3 times a second while your ear is in the air, and now you put your ear on the desk,
mm-hmm.
will you hear a different number of taps per second?
Yeah. No? Do you hear it directly through the
wood? Because think of this, if I tap it 3 times, is there any chance you'll hear 5 taps?
No.
No. In other words, that's frequency. Frequency is how often does this happen? I mean, how many things are happening per second? That can change. Or else, where would that be coming from? It's a philosophical question.
Right.
But you understand, it's like, really, if I tap 3 times, you're not going to expect 4 or 5 taps.
Right, okay.
All right?
Okay.
So frequency is how often something happens.
Right.
Is the wavelength of the sound that you hear
right.
in air the same as the wavelength of the
right.
sound you hear in the wood?
Because you might hear that
no.
first tap later.
Because the speed
yeah.
of sound in wood is different.
Yeah.
Hence the wavelengths have changed.
Yeah.
So wavelengths are generally the only thing that changes. Frequency stays locked. Having said that, with a lot of the new stuff that they're doing with nuclear stuff, they have found ways to force frequency changes. And it's kind of cutting edge and still kind of weird. I don't understand the physics of it myself yet. But we're not going there. So for us, the frequency is going to stay the same. Now, I don't know what the intent of your question was exactly.
I was just trying to understand why it happens.
All right. So, yeah. So what's going to happen then is that the frequency is going to stay the same. So blue, think of this. If that would change, your color would change on a rainy day when the index of refraction of air is slightly different than on a dry day. Or if you go underwater swimming, then you should be a totally different color than you are. And don't confuse that with the slight blue look that things get if they're far away. If I've got a flashlight shining on my arm underwater, it's my arm color. All right? It doesn't change because I'm in water.
Right.
All right. So frequency is what governs color, and that doesn't change. All right, so having said that then, here's the thing. How I did this was, there's a cheaper, easier way. All right, so basically what I said was this is 90 minus theta C. I said this is 90 minus theta B. And I know that 90 minus theta B plus alpha plus 90 minus theta C equals 180.
Yes.
Did everybody see that okay?
Yeah.
This, plus this are the three angles inside this triangle. And all triangles have to add up to 180 degrees. Say what? All right, no, look, is it working with me? This is a perpendicular line to this. So this is theta C that has to be 90 minus theta C because they have to add up to 90.
Oh.
Right? Same thing here. This is theta B, but this is flat, so that has to be a 90 degree angle. So if this is theta B, that has to be 90 minus theta B. Yeah?
Where'd you get the 180 though?
How many? If you add all three angles in a triangle, what does it add to? 180, right? It's one of the givens. All right, so.
Why is that little thing in the corner?
Why alpha.
Why is it included?
Because alpha is something that I'm trying to design a diamond. And alpha is the only thing I can pick.
Oh, like you're making.
I'm going to cut this diamond to make it look birdy.
I get it.
All right, and alpha is the only thing I can do. It's the only thing I can change about a diamond, for that angle. So what's that?
You get the angle C by finding the critical.
Yeah, I'm going to go there in just a second. So what I'm saying is, in order to make sure that this doesn't go out, I want to force this to be the critical angle, which I can figure out with this number. Did everybody get that? When I know the index of refraction of the diamond, I can find the critical angle. We've been doing it several previous homework problems. So given the index of refraction, I can find the critical angle. How? If 2.450 is n, I'm going to air, so I can find theta C. It's just a matter of using your calculator, right?
Yeah.
If I find theta C, what's the only unknown in this whole equation? I'm assuming I've got a particular alpha. So I choose an alpha, all right? And so once I pick an alpha, that'll tell me what theta B is, right?
can't you do the same thing for data Z as data C or no?
No, 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 because it's not grid length.
So wait, how are you choosing your alpha?
So in our particular problem, they gave me an alpha. They said they told me to choose 45. But what it is you can write a little computer program. You can just try a whole bunch of different alphas and see what happens. Because we're not done yet. Given alpha was 45 degrees, and everything else here, I know this from here. I can now solve for theta B. What that tells me is I can come back to this now, and I can find what theta A is. That tells me whatever theta A turns out to be, any angle smaller than that will come right back out. You got it? Once I find out what theta A is with that sign, because I designed it for critical angle, so if it satisfies the critical angle, it says any value you choose for theta A within that range is going to hit critical angle and therefore come right back out, making the diamond twice as much light as we would expect.
Here,
but
one more time.
Sure. But first, let's be sure we know how we got there. How did I get theta C? The critical angle, right? 45 was given. I can solve for theta B, right?
Yeah.
Now that I've solved for theta B, I come to the first thing here, and I just used the basic law, and it says sine theta A equals 2.450 sine theta B. Why don't I have anything in front? It's air. Right? Because I'm coming from here in. So it's air, theta A, equals mu index of refraction. So when I find what theta B is, I plug it into here, and I've got everything I need to find theta A. It's hard, but it's not overly difficult. You just have to kind of chase it here.
I am so sorry, but where do you get the 45
degrees? It's given in the problem.
It's given in the problem?
If it's not given in the problem, then we have two unknowns and we can't resolve it.
And then the 45 degree angle represents the theta, no, I'm sorry, alpha, right?
This is the 45 degree angle right here. I don't care that it's been shaved, because that's just the angle between those two surfaces of the diamond.
Oh, okay, so it's between this and this.
It's between this and this.
Okay.
Can you explain what angle A meant?
Yes. So angle A is incoming light. And let's say we solve this and we get 60 degrees. That tells me any angle that comes in from 0 to 60 is going to come right back out.
Oh, okay.
Any angle bigger than that might get refracted off the side and not make it out. But anything in that, not just back out, it'll come out the front of it, back to the eye, which makes it really sparkly. Yeah. Starting from where?
When you said it.
She was asking, what does theta A mean?
Yeah.
So when I solve this for theta A, theta A is the maximum angle that will come straight back out the other side, back into my face. Anything that comes in with an angle of 0 up to 60 will come right back out the front of the diamond. Any angle bigger than 60 is going to get probably out the sides of it. Now you can overcome that with a couple of other things that they do, but whatever. All right, good. Have any of you ever seen any really truly big, high-quality diamonds? I went to the Tower of London several years ago, and jewels just didn't mean that. I don't know, they're just jewels to me, right? But then I realized this because I've never seen any real jewels, because I went, and the way they have it is you can't see them when you first go down, it's like security out your ears, you go down these stairs, and down these stairs, and down these stairs, and in these dark rooms, finally you come in, they funnel you in, and you can't stop. You can walk around as many times you want, but you have to keep walking, you won't stop. That little thing they say is no shopping. So the thing is, part that's also because the lights they've got on as you walk. I stopped breathing. I have never seen anything so just fantastic in my life. All the crown jewels sitting in there. I mean, it looked like magic. You would have thought it was animated something because it couldn't be real life. I've never seen anything like it in my life. So I go, all right, I guess I can see why people fought wars over some of this stuff. the crown jewels.
No, where'd you go?
Oh, the Tower of London. If you ever have a chance to be in England, you have to go to the Tower of London, read up a little of the history. You get to see where Henry VIII killed all his wives, where he assassinated his two nephews, and it's an interesting place if you know anything about English history. All right, so back to this. Do you get it? Do you know what to do? Right, that's the hard problem. Everything else is pretty straightforward. Yeah.
Wait, you said you need to find theta B, or angle B to find angle A?
Yes.
How do you find angle B?
All right, so let's take this. First off, this is key. Do you know where I got this equation? Without this equation, everything is not going to happen. So we need to understand this equation. All right, so let's chase this through. I said that if we have light coming from theta to A, it's refracted to theta B, which hits this surface, and I want this to be a critical angle. I called it theta C, but I'm going to make it be a critical angle, which means it's going to reflect right back in. It's not going to go out the other side. All right, so when I did that, I said, look, this is perpendicular to the surface, this is perpendicular to this surface. If this is theta B, then this angle is 90 minus theta B. And if this is theta C, then this angle is 90 minus theta C. And then I look at this triangle. And the sum of angles in a triangle adds up to what? 180. And that's 90 minus theta B plus 90 minus theta C plus alpha. That's equal to 180. That's where it comes from. All right. Then how do I get theta C? It's just the critical angle formula. So I just use the critical angle formula. All right, we're done.
That was so
perfect.
I did everything.
Did
I put it in and it says it's wrong?
Well, how are you doing it? So you put sine theta C equals 1 over 2.450. Right? And so then you take the arc sine of that. Are you in degrees?
Yes. All the time.
All right. So 1 divided by 2.450 equals arc cosine. Did you say arc sine? So you got 24.1 or whatever.
Yeah.
We have to keep four significant digits, so we got 24.09. Mm-hmm. All right, and so that tells me theta C.
So I plugged it into that equation. So the only thing that I don't know is the theta B, right?
So this all cancels, and I get that minus theta B plus 45 degrees minus 24.09 equals zero. So then I get minus 45 is theta B is equal to 20.91,
yep.
Right? Then I come up and I say, all right, then sine, sine of that is equal to 0.3569.
Yeah.
And you multiply by 2.54.
Yeah.
0.45. 0.45 equals. And then you take the arc sine of that.
That's 60.9.
And I get 16.9. You get 16.98. Did you put 16.98?
16.98.
And they don't accept it?
I have 974.
So you can't have 974. Then you type something wrong. Try 60.98.
But you did round.
I did. But no, I kept four significant digits.
Yeah,
no,
I kept more too. It's still wrong.
Mine gave me the right answer, 60.98.
Well, I put that in.
But you might have different numbers than I have.
No, they're the exact same.
All right, I'll take a look at it later.
I mean, unless we had to put red into account.
No.
Yeah, the blue is the same.
Could that be different? They have to give it to someone. You skipped a bundle of steps. They first asked you for this. You got the final answer, which is theta A. They're not asking theta A. They're going to give you the 45 degrees in part B. So you skip to the final answer. You're skipping all. Read the question. Is that find theta C? Let's just skip that intermediate stuff. All right. No. So trust me. I honestly do work these out to be sure that I know that they work before I give them to you. All right. Now, having said that, then here's the thing that happens next. We decide there's this thing called reflection, this thing called refraction. From this, we build optical devices based on these two principles. And it's a kind of a duh moment, but the optical device that's built on refraction is called what? What device do we use based on indices of refraction?
Telescope.
Am I the only one in the room? No, thank you, Saida and Kit. Oh, we've got Saida, all right.
Glasses.
Oh, without the indices of refraction, these would not work for us. All right, these are based on the idea of finding an index of refraction bending light a particular way. So what we have then is, that's the devices we get with using refraction. What devices do we have that use reflection? Mirror. Now, where we typically run into that is like the typical bathroom mirror, which is flat. But it turns out that you can also make mirrors that are curved. Have you ever, you're all so young, did anybody ever watch the first Jurassic Park from about 150 years ago?
Yeah.
All right. So you know that scene where they say the T-Rex is chasing him and they look and says, objects in this mirror may be closer than they appear?
Yeah.
That's a mirror that's acting like a lens, so it's curved out, making so you can see more of the area, but everything has a smaller size. We'll learn about that. So you can use mirrors to make objects as well, I mean images as well, right? So, I mean, we have mirrors, of course, a bathroom mirror making an image, but we call what kind of image based on what I told you last time?
Virtual.
Virtual, because I'm not really there, thank goodness, right? But you can make images that are real. Have you all ever seen real images with mirrors? I will lure you into class on Monday by bringing a device that will make real images and it will blow your mind if you've never seen them.
Spoon.
If you have ever been to the exploratorium, you've seen them. They're really cool.
Yeah. Okay.
Because you swear they're there and then they aren't.
Yeah.
All right, so the mirrors we can make images. So the next thing that we're gonna lead into is, how do we use these to make, for useful? And I'm gonna give you the next equation that comes down the road for us, and this equation lasts for a long time, and I want to get it on the table so you can start processing the information. Oh, I know 700 versions of the equation. I've forgotten which letters our author uses. Because everybody uses different letters, and it gets really annoying. I think he uses S and I. Oh, he uses S in his front. All right, I'll go. So here's the equation that we call the thin lens equation, or the mirror equation, or any kind of equation. And I want to get these terms out there and get you used to it. This is what we call image distance. Object distance. Excuse me. I did that entirely backwards. Just give me a moment to wake up. Object distance and image distance. And focal length.
From where?
All right, so the lens or the mirror is the starting point for all of this. Because it's doing whatever it's doing. So if I draw a mirror, let's say just put a mirror here for right now. And the way we'll do this is we're going to make our mirrors spherical. So it's going to be a piece of a sphere. And I put it such that a line drawn through it has the same amounts above and below. You understand I can do that with any curved mirror you give me, and I can find the middle and draw a line like this. Are we good at that? This is called the axis of the lens, all right? All right, so then here's the deal. Everything